In this session of numerical methods, I like to continue discussing computer arithmetic. So it's important to understand how the computer performs its calculations. And we already started a short session on this, looking at integers. And today my focus is on floating point numbers, which will keep us busy during the next sessions. So in addition to representing some integer numbers, the computer can represent a subset of the real numbers, the floating point numbers. Of course, it is a finite set. And I discuss now the IEEE 754 standard to represent real numbers, which is a very popular standard, which is underlying many floating point numbers in many representations in many different programming languages or frameworks like C, C++, C Sharp, Java, Scala, whatever, MATLAB, R, and so on. So what you learn here now is a little bit independent of the programming language. So the floating point numbers, they are represented or encoded by three integers, S, C, and E. And S is actually just one bit, it's 0 or 1, and it's representing the sign. The number, the integer number C is somewhat representing the value. So say something like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, something like that. And what is then E? E is representing the scale. So like 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, 1 million. So there is a splitting between value and scale, so certain values and then certain scales. But instead of being based to the power of 10, as I just did in my example, it's all based to. Well, you can define this standard in a very general way, but what I discuss here is the base 2 representation of these numbers. Okay, so we have three integers. These three integers, they have different ranges. For the sign, we need one bit to represent 0 or 1, plus or minus. Then for C, the range is 0, including 2 to the power of p, not included. So we need p bits. And then for the E, we have that E is between E min and E max, both are included. So between E min and E max, there are E max minus E min plus 1 numbers. And we use 2 to the power of R numbers. So we require R bits here. So we require here R bits to represent this range, and we require p bits to represent that range for C and E. So in sum, we require 1 plus p plus r bits. So, and sometimes we use in total 32 bits, which is then a single precision floating point numbers, or we use in total 64 bits, which is then a double precision floating point number. And the choice of P and R, they may depend, and I will discuss that later. So how do we now use these three integers, S, C, and E, to encode a subset of R? So the computer represents a certain subset of the real numbers, the floating point numbers, and they are encoded using these three integer values. Well, what you will see now is that this subset of the floating point numbers is described by three different definitions, and they all describe disjoint parts of this set. And the first definition is the so-called normalized floating point numbers. So what are the normalized floating point numbers? So here's the definition. So for a fixed value, P, E min, and E max. So E min can be negative. Yeah. So a normalized based 2 floating point number is given by the following definition. X is minus 1 to the power of S. So that's encoding the sign. So if S is 0, it's plus. If S is 1, it's a minus. 1 plus C divided by 2 to the power of P times 2 to the power of E. So we immediately have here that 1 plus C divided by 2 to the power of P. Okay, this is in the interval. So have a look. Since C is between 0 and 2 to the power of P, this is in the interval 1 included, 2 not included. Because if I want to represent 2, then I just increment here the exponent e to the next scale, and I set C back to 0. So how does this set look? So maybe let's draw here a line. Okay, so then I have some, let's look at the positive numbers. Then I have some smallest positive number, although, okay, that is C equals 0, E equals E min plus 1. Because E is larger than E min and E is an integer. So somewhere here we have the number C is equal to 0 and E is equal to E min plus 1. And it's the positive ones, so S is equal to 0. So and that number here is plus 2 to the power of E min plus 1. Okay, so then I can increment C to get more and more larger numbers. And the next number where C is 0 is maybe here, it's 2 to the power of E min plus 2. And the next number then has a twice as large interval. And the next number is 2 to the power of E min plus 3. And in between, I can vary the number C, the integer C, from 0, including, to 2 to the power of P minus 1, including. So now assume that P is equal to 2. Then this means C can attain the values 0, 1, 2, or 3. Okay, so I have these four numbers. So this here is C equals 0, and then I have 2, 1, or 3. Okay, and the next level will be here 2, 1, 0, or 3. So I have some kind of equidistribution within the scale. So for a fixed E, C is performing some equidistribution of the numbers within the scale, but the scale is getting larger and larger. Of course, I have the same on the negative side. So somewhere here there is the 0, And we have the same on the negative side. Again, with C performing some equidistribution. And you see the number zero is not included in this set. Okay, surprise. Zero is not included in this set. So we see that the open set from minus 2 to the power of e min plus 1 to plus 2 to the power of e min plus 1 is not in this set. Okay, so we cannot represent the numbers around zero, so some numbers around zero, and we cannot represent the number zero. But look, the set of the floating point numbers contains the normalized floating point numbers, and we will add more numbers in one of the next definitions. If you look here, we allow that the exponent e is between e min and e max including. So e equals e min is possible and e equals e max is possible. So on this definition, the exponent is allowed to be between e min and e max not included. So we still have something left to encode more numbers. For example, we can use e equals e min to encode more numbers. So we cannot encode the zero with this form here, because there's always a one plus something and then something which makes it to another scale. So we have to switch to a different representation if we get closer to zero. So before we switch to the different representation, let me discuss some properties of these numbers. So these numbers have a remarkable property. Assume you have a function that actually results in some value which is not in this set. For example, this value here. In that case, the computer has to round to the nearest representative in his set of floating point numbers. So the set of floating point numbers will again define an equivalence class. In that case, we are interested actually in the size of this gap here. So what is the distance of two numbers? And a remarkable property of these floating point numbers is that the relative distance of two such numbers is bounded by a constant. Yeah, so it is approximately always the same. So why is that? So two nearby normalized floating point numbers have approximately the same relative distance. So why is that? Okay, let's have a look. Assume that we have a floating point numbers in normalized form. So then it is represented in this form, 1 plus c divided by 2p times 2 to the power of e. So then the next number is 1 plus c plus 1. Divided by 2 to the power of p, multiplied with 2 to the power of e. Well, you might say, okay, that is true if c is smaller than 2 to the power of e, 2 to the power of p minus 2. But what happens if c is equal to 2 to the power of p minus 1? Then I cannot increment c. So then it will flip over. So if c is equal to 2 to the power of p minus 1, then c plus 1 will be 2 to the power of p. That means that c plus 1 will move to c equals 0, and e will move to e plus 1. So, which is actually the same, yeah, because 1 plus 1 times 2 to the power of e is the same as 1 plus 0 times 2 to the power of e plus 1. No? It's just multiplied by 2. Okay, so I have that if this here is a floating point number, then the next number is of this form here. So what's now the relative distance of these two numbers? So that's the difference x2 minus x1. So that's the difference x2 minus x1 divided by x1. So x2 minus x1 is just 1 plus c divided c plus 1 divided by 2 to the power of p minus 1 plus c divided by 2 to the power of p. So the 1 cancels and I just have c plus 1 divided by 2 to the power of p minus c. So that's just 1 divided by 2 to the power of p times 2 to the power of e divided by 1 plus c divided by 2 to the power of t times 2 to the power of e. And you see that the scale is canceling. So, and this guy here below is always larger than 1. So you see that this is in this interval here. And from that, I have that x2 minus x1 divided by x1 is smaller than 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. And I just looked here at the positive number. If you have a negative number, that also holds here with the absolute value. So I have a bound on the relative distance. And actually, that means I have a bound on the rounding error. Because if you go back to this picture here, and now you say that the rounding error is just half of this interval, then I have that the rounding error is now bounded by 1 divided by 2 to the power of p plus 1. So that's a nice thing here. It will lead to the fact that the rounding error is bounded by 1 divided by 2p plus 1. Four numbers within this set, that are in this set. Okay, this is a nice property. We have a bound on the rounding error. So, but recall the point that no number from this interval minus 2 to the power of e min to plus 2 to the power of e min is part of the set of normalized floating point numbers. So we need to add some more numbers if we like to represent also numbers in this interval. Okay, this is in the script just a drawing, yeah, which is a little bit similar to what I just have drawn by hand. And now comes another definition. So in addition, the computer can represent another set of numbers, so which also then will contain the zero. This set is called the denormalized numbers. Okay, this is just the name for this set. Yeah. So normalized, denormalized numbers are two different sets. The union of the set will then be part of my floating point numbers. So here is the definition of the denormalized numbers. So if E is equal to E min, I will switch to this set. So you see that E does not play a role here. So for a fixed P and a fixed E min, the set of denormalized floating point numbers is given by this definition here. So X is minus 1 to the power of S. So S is again encoding the sign, times C divided by 2 to the power of P times 2 to the power of E min plus 1. So you see for C equals 0, I have that this number is 0. So let me draw this set. So for S equals 0, C equals 0, I have the number is 0. So here's somewhere 0. And then C runs from 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on to 2 to the power of P, not included. Yeah. So the first number that I cannot represent is C. Equals 2 to the power of P, S equals 0. So that is 2 to the power of P divided by 2 to the power of P multiplied with 2 to the power of E min plus 1. So that's plus, this number is not part of this set, huh? Because it's the bound for C, but in between I have an equidistribution. So if I assume that P is equal to 2, then this means C can attain the number 0, 1, 2, or 3. Then I have here 2, 1, 3. I have these four numbers on the positive side. And I have the same for the negative side, where the bound is now here minus 2 to the power of E min plus 1. And I have an equidistribution in between. Yeah, C equals 2, C equals 1, C equals 3, and C equals 0. So you see, there's a special thing here. I have two different ways of representing zero. There is a plus zero and a minus zero. And these different ways of representing zero will become handy, yeah, in some cases. Now, that's a funny thing. And you see that this set is exactly filling the gap that was left over by the normalized floating point numbers. Because if we go back, we see that here the smallest positive normalized floating point numbers was indeed the 2 to the power of E min plus 1. So we have that here is the set of normalized floating point numbers. And also here on the negative side. And this set now contains the region around zero, and it contains zero. Okay. Well, since this set contains zero, looking at the relative distance doesn't make sense, yeah, because you could divide by zero. But here, of course, on this set, you have a bound on the absolute distance. And the absolute distance is here the size of this interval. Okay, and the size of this interval is 2 to the power of E min plus 1 minus P. So that's the smallest possible distance within the denormalized floating point numbers. So we have a bound on the absolute error within the denormalized floating point numbers. So when does the computer know which of the two representation is valid? So actually here he switches to this representation. If the integer e is equal to e min, okay? So remember our e was from the range e min to e max, e min including, e max including, and for the normalized, I only used e between e min and e max, both not included. So I can use e equals e min to switch to the other representation. So if e is equal to e min, I switch to the other representation and I'm encoding the numbers in this range here. Yeah. So you see that these numbers here are the numbers e equals to e min. So you could also say that this here is then 2 to the e plus 1. Yeah. Okay, so we still have one little set left, the set where e is equal to e max, and these numbers are used for special values that are far out, yeah, for example, like infinity or something like that. I will come to this. So here's a little drawing, maybe a little bit nicer, yeah, of the denormalized floating point number. So you see that 2 to the power of e min plus 1 is not included, and in between it's an equidistribution within this interval, and it includes 0. The absolute distance of two adjacent numbers is constant. So as I already said, in addition, we can encode some more values, well, maybe not values, special objects, and these objects are encoded by e is equal to e max, and if c is equal to 0, this encodes plus or minus infinity depending on s being 0 or 1. So we can encode plus or minus infinity. And for c equals not 0, we have the special value not a number. So not a number is like an error occurred. Yeah, for example, we will get not a number if we draw a square root out of a negative number. So example is here square root of minus 1 will lead to not a number. I will have a session on plus and minus infinity in the next session of the lecture. So we will look into this later. So now we have used up all our integers. Okay, so let me add here again a drawing of all three encodings. So we have here our plus or minus 0 coming from the denormalized numbers. Then the normalized numbers start maybe here. Okay, they have an increasing scale, yeah, that is doubling. Okay, and in between the denormalized ones, we have an equipartitioning, and also in between the normalized ones, there is an equipartitioning. The same on the negative side. And then if all the numbers are exhausted, there is an additional number or an additional symbol, and this guy here is plus infinity, and this guy here is minus infinity. So we have these three sets. So this here is our definition three. And this here is our definition one, the normalized ones. And definition three is the denormalized ones. Okay. So how many numbers can we represent here? So that, of course, depends on the ranges. So if we have 32 bits, these are the floating point, single precision floating point numbers. So then usually we use 8 bits for the exponent E and 32 bits for the mantissa, so for the C, so P is equal to 32. And if we have double precision floating point numbers using 64 bit, we use 11 bit for the exponent and 52 bits for the mantissa. No? So the P is equal to 52. And if you have 11 bits, yeah, you can represent 2048 numbers. Yeah, so if your exponent has 11 bit, you can represent 2 to the power of 11, which is 2048. And now you can choose how you distribute the exponents. So what kind of exponents we allow. And here our E for the normalized floating point numbers is between 1000 minus 1023. So E min is minus 1023. Yeah, so this here is just for the normalized floating point numbers. And the E max is 1024. Okay, so and that's quite a bit range. And for the C, yeah, if we use for the C 52 bits, that means that P is equal to 52. And this means this rounding error. So 1 divided by 2 to the power of 52 plus 1. So this is 2 to the power of minus 53. Well, this is actually 1024, which is 2 to the power of 10 to the power of minus 5.3. So 1000 is 2 to the power of 3. So this is approximately 10 to the minus 3 times 5.3 is approximately 16. Yeah. So that is approximately 10 to the minus 16. Okay, so we expect that the rounding error is 10 to the minus 16. So I like to conclude this session with a small experiment in the computer and explore these numbers in the computer. We will start with more computer experiments in the next session. So here are two exercises. What is the smallest positive non-zero floating point value? So in Java, it's called double dot min value of type double. So we answered this already during the lecture. So for one, this is actually our definition three, because this is the smallest non-zero floating point number, the first number after the zero. This is a denormalized number. So it is the number one, c equals one, divided by 2 to the power of p times 2 to the power of e min plus 1. And this is the number 2 to the power of e min plus 1 minus p. Okay, and this is the number 2. So e min is minus 1023. So this is minus 1023 plus 1 minus 52. And the second question, what is the smallest number x such that 1 and 1 plus x are two different floating point numbers? So actually, I'm looking at the x, which is just in between 1 and the next floating point number. So this number here is c equals 0. And this number here is c equals 1. On the scale, e equals 0, 2 to the power of e is then 1, e equals 0. Okay, so this means that 2x is 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. So this means that the x is our rounding error, 1 divided by 2 to the power of p plus 1. And I already looked at this. This is approximately 10 to the minus 16. So now I like to look at these two questions using a small computer experiment. So I like to find these numbers by performing some calculations. So let's create here a small experiment. So I create a class, let's call it floating point arithmetic experiments. Okay, I would like to have a main method to perform some calculations and have some printout here. So the first question is, I like to have the smallest positive non-zero number. So maybe I start with a guess. Yeah. So let's assume the number is 1. And then I make the number smaller. So while tiny is larger than 0, I make the number smaller. So while tiny is larger than 0, I will have that tiny is tiny divided by 2. Okay, so if I now print tiny, it will be 0. So let's print this number. So if I print this number, I assume it will be 0 because the loop stops when the number is not larger than 0. So let's run this little program. Okay, so you see tiny is 0. So now let's stop just one step before. So I stop if tiny divided by 2 will be not larger than 0. Okay, so I stop one step before. So, and let's have a look what's that. So that is 4.9 times 10 to the minus 324. So let's go back to the script. So here we actually calculated 2 to the power of minus 1023 plus 1 minus 52. So let's also print this. So let's print 2 to the power of minus 1023 plus 1 minus 52. So let's print that, yeah, make it a little bit nicer. So I would like to print the power 2 to the power of minus 1023 plus 1 minus 52. So let's run the program and we see that, okay, that's exactly this number. Okay, hopefully he is able to calculate this here correctly. Okay, so let's experiment a little with this number. So actually what happens if I divide tiny again by 2? So tiny divided by 2 will be 0. Okay, so what happens if you divide tiny by 2 and then multiply with 2 again? Okay, so actually that should be, mathematically speaking, again, tiny. So, no, it remains 0, because if I multiply 0 with 2, it remains 0. What happens if we do it the other way around? Yeah, if we multiply tiny with 2 and then divide by 2. So I multiply with 2 and I divide by 2. Okay, the other way around. So what happens then? So it remains, of course, tiny. Yeah, multiplying with 2, dividing by 2, it remains tiny. So you see, actually here, there is a fundamental law violated. Okay, so maybe that is not such a big problem because it is here in a very small scale that this is violated, but we will encounter situations where similar problems are of high importance. And let me make one other experiment related now here to the number 2 on this slide. What is the smallest number x such that 1 and 1 plus 2x are different? So that means 1 plus x, yeah, is rounded either to 1 or to 1 plus 2x. So it's just in between. So let's try that in a similar fashion. Yeah. So let's start with a guess. So I call this number epsilon. So I start with 1.0. And now my loop is while 1 plus epsilon is larger than 1. So while 1 plus epsilon can be distinguished from 1. I like to make epsilon smaller. Okay. So it is epsilon is equal epsilon divided by 2. Okay, so let's print out this epsilon. Okay. And we see that this is indeed 10 to the minus 16. Yeah. So this looks like our 2 to the power of minus 52. So let's print the 2 to the power of minus 53. Yeah. So let's print the 2 to the power of minus 53. So what's that? Yeah, that's the same number. Okay, 10 to the minus 16. So we are exactly now, the epsilon is the point in between 1 and 1 plus x, which is the next, 1 plus 2x, which is the next floating point number. So this epsilon is just cutting this interval between 1 and the next floating point number. So let's also play a little bit with this epsilon. So what is actually, if we try to compare 1 plus epsilon and 1. So is 1 plus epsilon equal to 1? So 1 plus epsilon equal to 1. Let's run the program. And we see 1 plus epsilon is equal to 1. That's true. Okay, so 1 plus epsilon cannot be distinguished from 1. And actually this thing here, that 1 plus epsilon cannot be distinguished from 1. So we have a precision of, say, a relative error, relative distance of 10 to the minus 16 will actually be the root of all evil. And we will explore this in one of our next sessions on floating point numbers with more computer experiments. So here on the slides, you find a link to the code we prepared today, and we will continue in one of the next sessions, so you can have a look at the GitHub repository that is written here and play a little bit with these experiments. Thank you.